This video is intended for anyone caring for children, as a parent, a care provider, a medic or paramedic, a teacher or whatever. It explains the most common reasons for knee pain in children 4 to 12 years old, how you can come to the correct diagnosis and what the treatment is. First of all, it is important to realize that the musculoskeletal system of a child is not just a mini version of the adult. Therefore, what can go wrong in the knee of a child is completely different to what occurs in the knee of an adult. The reason is that a child is still growing, and therefore the bones in the body contain growth plates, which are weak spots, and also, per definition, the tissues in the body of the child are still immature, and therefore not as strong as in the adult, which may easily lead to overload, such as for example on the cartilage. As a consequence, typical problems may occur, depending on the age and the maturity of the child. If we combine that with knowledge about the exact location of the pain and its specific characteristics, it is often easy to make the correct diagnosis, because these factors are highly predictive. As a matter of fact, there are only a handful of conditions that may actually be present, and these are listed here. I will discuss them one by one. The first one is growing pains. Growing pains occur in 4 out of 10 children, usually between the ages of 4 to 8 years, and usually the pain is located just above or below the knee, or just above or below the ankle, on one side only, or both sides at the same time, or a mixed appearance, on any of the locations that you see here in the drawing. Usually the pain starts during periods of rest, for example in the evening, or during the first part of the night, when the child wakes up in pain and starts crying. Sometimes the pain can be very pronounced, and the strange thing is that there are no other symptoms, no swelling, no local warmth or redness, no fever, in fact, nothing else to see or to detect, except the pain. And also, there seems to be no clear reason for the pain. There was no special trauma during the day, also no special vigorous activity. The child just seemingly had a standard day of playing and being active, nothing special. So understandably, this may be very worrisome to the parents, because obviously the child is in very much pain, since it made the child wake up and cry. But fortunately, growing pains are benign. They disappear spontaneously. What exactly is the cause of growing pains is not 100% surely known yet, but probably it is the traction of the muscles and the tendons onto the bones caused by the longitudinal growth of the bones that provoke the pain during periods of rest. As I said, growing pains disappear spontaneously, but that may take several hours, up to 5 hours even. Eventually though, the child will fall asleep again and continue to sleep peacefully the rest of the night. And the next morning, all the pain is gone and it seems as if nothing has happened. There is not so much you can do about growing pains. There is indeed not so much that helps. Warm compresses or a warm bath or a localized gentle massage over the painful area can sometimes help to alleviate the pain. Indeed, growing pains often respond favorably to gentle tactile intervention, which is in contrast to many other causes of pain. 2. Osgood-Schlatter. Osgood-Schlatter occurs in sports active children, usually from the age of 7 to 8 years. It is an overload problem of the patellar tendon at the tibial attachment, which we call the apophysis. The overload is caused by prolonged and intensive quadriceps contractions, which are transmitted over the kneecap to the patellar tendon and its insertion on the tibial apophysis, creating traction and overload there. The consequence is local pain and inflammation. We call that grade 1. And if the overload continues, leading to some separation of the apophysis, that is grade 2, which is easily visible on a radiograph. Often one can then see some local swelling over this region, which we call the tibial tuberosity. Obviously, this condition causes local pain at the insertion of the patellar tendon, which logically is located somewhat under the knee, as you can see here. The treatment consists of an immediate reduction or sport stop. In some severe cases, even some temporary immobilization in a cast or a brace is needed to put the leg into complete rest. In more mild cases, that is not needed, and some local anti-inflammatory measures, such as an anti-inflammatory pomade or a gel or a patch, is sufficient. Important is also to bring the quadriceps and hamstring muscles to length by a stretching program, because these muscles are usually too short in these kids as a consequence of growth, and this contributes to the problem. Once the pain is gone, a gradual build-up in sports is allowed again, with help of a protective strap or tape to relieve some of the traction and to remind the child to be gradual in building up again. 3. Sinding Larsen Johansson. Sinding Larsen Johansson is the analogue of Osgood-Schlatter, but now on the other side of the patellar tendon. It occurs also in sports-active children from the age of 8 to 9 years old. So now the overload is at the patellar attachment of the tendon and causes local pain and inflammation there. In case the overload continues, also here, some separation may occur, which then becomes visible on ultrasound or x-ray. So, in Sinding, Larsen, Johansson, the pain is also in the front of the knee, but now around the lower edge and the tip of the kneecap. The treatment is similar to Osgood-Schlatter. Reduction or even full sports stop until the pain has gone. Temporary immobilization in the very severe cases. Local anti-inflammatory pomade or gel or patches in the more mild cases. Quadriceps and hamstring stretches, because these are usually also too tight and contribute here. And afterwards, when the pain has gone, gradual return to sports with a supportive strap or cross tape. 4. Discoid or hypermobile lateral meniscus. In about 4% of children, the lateral meniscus, which is the outer shock absorber of the knee, develops somewhat abnormally, and this leads to either a more rectangular shape, which we call discoid, a semi-discoid shape, or an absent attachment to the capsule, which we then call a hypermobile lateral meniscus. The typical symptom is pain on the lateral or outward side of the knee, usually starting around the age of 6 to 10 years, when the child is increasingly engaging in sports. Often, there is also a clicking or snapping sensation in the knee. An MRI is needed to confirm the diagnosis and to find out how the meniscus deviates from the normal wedge shape. In young children, below 8 to 10 years, temporary immobilization of the knee in a cast or brace for 4 to 6 weeks, followed by a strengthening program, may be sufficient as a treatment. This will allow the meniscus to develop more firmly. If the child is older, this approach is less likely to be effective. Surgical treatment is then indicated, during which the meniscus shape and its attachment to the capsule are restored. 5. Chondromalacia patellae. Chondromalacia patellae is abnormally soft cartilage at the kneecap. It is frequently seen in girls and usually starts to cause pain around the age of 9. It is therefore also commonly called young girl's knee or anterior knee pain syndrome. The pain is located in the front of the knee around the kneecap, usually on both sides left and right. Usually these children have also hypermobile joints, flat feet and inward knee torsion, which is often clearly visible when you observe the knees from the front during stance. Fortunately, chondromalacia patellae is not a medically dangerous condition, and the symptoms usually disappear spontaneously as maturation progresses and the cartilage becomes firmer. However, this may take a very long time, and in the meantime, the symptoms may linger on, much to the frustration of the child and the parents. Optimizing leg alignment with corrective exercises and orthotics will often alleviate the symptoms. Together with a knee strengthening program, which should be gradually individualized and within the comfort zone. 6. Plica syndrome. In Plica syndrome, there is inflammation of the joint capsule on the medial side of the patella. It frequently comes together with the previous condition, chondromalacia patellae, so often in girls from the age of 9. The pain is then on the medial side of the kneecap. In most cases, the inflammation is temporary, and local anti-inflammatory treatment with ice applications and an anti-inflammatory gel or patches is sufficient, combined with the measures similar as for the treatment of chondromalacia patellae, optimization of leg alignment through corrective exercises and appropriate orthotics, together with a knee strengthening program. 7. Osteochondritis dissecans. Osteochondritis dissecans is a very localized weak zone of cartilage and bone that may gradually become loose, that is stage 2, and detached, that is stage 3. Usually, osteochondritis dissecans occurs at an age of 8 years or older, and the frequency is 3 times higher in boys than in girls. Frequently, the weak spot is located on the medial side of the knee, but in fact it can be anywhere. The pain is often vague, somewhere deep in the knee, and occurs especially during activity. Sometimes there is also swelling or a locking sensation, but that means that it is already in stage 2 or even 3. For the diagnosis and to determine the correct stage, you need an MRI. In stage 1, the treatment consists of immobilization in a cast or brace with 4 to 6 weeks of non-weight bearing. In stage 2, preventive pinning fixation by surgery is required to avoid detachment. And in stage 3, surgical extraction with reconstruction of the defect is needed. Finally, slipped epiphyses of the hip. Actually, this is a hip problem causing pain in the knee. What happens is that the femoral head is slipping off the femoral neck. And that is a dangerous condition. It usually happens in kids older than 8 years and overweight is a risk factor. Frequently, there is pain both in the knee and the groin. But sometimes there is only pain in the knee, which can be very confusing because there is nothing wrong in the knee. Typically, the child is also limping, which in fact is an alarm sign when you notice that. An X-ray will confirm the diagnosis, with the radiographs being taken in the so-called frog position, as you can see here. As I said, slipped epiphysis of the hip is a dangerous condition, because it may jeopardize the viability of the hip. It is therefore considered as a medical emergency. Weight-bearing should be stopped immediately, and urgent surgical fixation is required. So this really should not be missed. So with this, we have covered the vast majority of reasons for knee pain in children. I would say more than 98%, apart from the trivial bumps, knocks and bruises. But caution, there exist a few rare conditions in children which are associated with knee pain, but where other symptoms are far more important. And it is essential to realize that none of these symptoms are present in the list of 8 conditions that I have just discussed. And these symptoms are fever, sickness, general symptoms such as weight loss, loss of appetite, extreme fatigue, the inability to move the knee, perseverance of the knee pain despite treatment. If any of these symptoms is present, further investigation is required at the short term. I would even say at the first possible occasion. Thank you for watching.